that means, hey, we're going to get out of here. I'm going to get some sleep today. Amen. We've been talking about the kingdom. We started talking about shifting into high gear, but then we went into the subject of the kingdom. And how many of you know, as we talked about the kingdom, that there's an understanding that we need to have, that there's a difference between kingdom and church, or kingdom and religion. And for many of us, I don't know about you all, but for me, I was always taught religion. I was taught how to be religious. I never was taught how to get things, or I was told that you could get, call those things that be not as though they were, but it was never explained to me that this is a real thing that God has for us, and it is a part of our, it's a part of our inheritance. It is a part of who we are when we become born again. It's a right of yours that you should get everything that the kingdom has, you should have. Now, and I'm going to show you later how this happens, but there are ways that you have two Christians that can hear the same thing, but if they can operate differently, and one will live an abundant life, and one will live a defeated life. They can hear the exact same message, but it always comes to the application of you putting everything into action. And all of this thing rolls around to faith. Y'all hear me? Everything rolls around to faith because things are going to happen regardless of where you are in life. It's how you handle it. We're going to be touching on something on Sundays, on this Sunday, about how a storm of life will come, but then it's how are you going to handle your storm? Are you going to have no faith, little faith, no faith, or great faith?
Yeah.
Amen? And so tonight, I want you to really, for the few minutes we're going to be together, a lot of people are out because I had some people there. They're working with the Edward Hawkins celebration, which I appreciate. Some people are singing with them, they are there, but I dare not cancel what we have because we still need to govern this body, amen?
Amen.
And so those of you who will be going with me tomorrow, please see me right after. If you're interested in going and helping out with the celebration, please don't hesitate to let me know tonight, and I'll give you all the details. We did talk about it last week, how we lost our place. Remember that? We lost our place once Adam sinned, right? We lost our place, and we needed a Savior. And we got kicked out, quote unquote, of the kingdom. The kingdom at that specific time for us was the Garden of Eden. Y'all remember that? And so that when we sinned, we got kicked out. Even though He gave us grace, He wound up covering us. He covered Adam. He covered Eve from their nakedness. But He did kick them out of the kingdom and put an angel at the edge of the Garden of Eden so that they could not re-enter. So at the time, we had no interest back into the kingdom. But because of the love of Jesus, and He gave His only begotten Son, we have access back into the kingdom. And that's why you should really come to church, come to Bible study, especially come to church. You should definitely come to church, definitely with a praise on your lips, no matter what is going on throughout your week, because you have access back to the throne. You don't have to go through the pastor to get to God.
Yeah.
You don't need the pastor is here, but you don't have to follow a Moses to get to God. You're fine over here. Everybody just over here. what I want you to understand is that two kingdoms, y'all remember that? What are the two kingdoms?
The kingdom of this earth, the earthly kingdom.
Earthly kingdom and
kingdom of God.
And the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven. What's the two kingdoms?
The earthly kingdom and the and the kingdom of heaven.
Now, how do you know? Now, who's the ruler of this earthly kingdom?
Satan.
Okay. Now, understand that. So, while we're living here on earth, Satan is the ruler of the earth. So, you're probably wondering why you get messed with all the time.
Yep.
You're probably wondering why, because you're going against the ruler of this kingdom. And understand that if you go against my rules, I'm going to get you. Or try to, at least. You know what I mean? So he is the ruler of this kingdom. And what you need to understand is that music, entertainment, all of that stuff is under his rulership. So you got to make certain that you understand. That's why music, have you noticed that music, and how can a rapper make more money than a teacher? Because I want this system to where everybody focus on this system. Because remember, worship or music was made to edify God. The purpose of it was to edify God. So I need to make certain in my kingdom we do the opposite. And if you do the opposite, I will raise you up. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So you have people who mumble words. I don't even know what they're saying.
Right.
Notice that people will buy $300, $400, $500, $600, $700 seats to go see a Beyonce or Bruno Mars or anybody, but they won't pay $20 to go somewhere and see somebody at church. Because it's the culture, the system says that the enemy rules this system. And so what we want to understand is that we're not, even though we're in the system, we're not of the system. And that you don't have to subject yourself to what the system dictates for you. You can actually, you have power enough and authority enough to be able to take control of anything that happens in your life.
Right.
Amen.
You can take control of your attitude right now.
I agree.
You can take control. You don't have to be mad. Okay. You don't have to be upset. You don't have to, because you can command your soul. You can command your hands. You can command your lips to praise. You can command yourself, self, come out of this. Okay? And so that's when we start operating into the kingdom. We understand we don't have to take everything that the enemy sends. Did y'all hear me? When you're part of the kingdom, you don't have to take everything that the enemy sends. So the Bible says in Romans 12 and 2, remember we said that? Mm-hmm. Do not conform to what?
To this world.
But be ye by the renewing of the mind. How many of us, and I mean, if we were to be honest, how many of us really renew our minds daily? I said daily. Now, we may renew our minds when we come to church, but what about on a random Thursday? Most of us, let me tell you when most of us decide to get on the attack. Let me tell you when most of us start trying to renew our minds. We start renewing our minds when it's too late. We start renewing our minds after the enemy attacks us.
You're right.
We don't go on the offensive. We stay on the defensive. We wait until something happens to us, then we respond. We don't wake up with it on our minds, I need to renew my mind now before anything happens so I can be prepared. We don't put on our armor first. Many of us do not put on our armor first. We try to put on the armor after the fiery darts have been shot.
Right.
You try to put the joy, talking about the joy of the Lord is my strength, after you got a flat tire. Now you're trying to figure out where the joy is. Y'all know what I'm saying. After you get a flat tire, after something happened to your car, after something happened to your kids, after something happened to your finances, Then, now we seek the kingdom.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we didn't seek the kingdom when everything was all right. Mm-hmm. All right? And so we have to make sure that we stop allowing the enemy to dictate our days and dictate our weeks. How many of you are tired of that? I don't know about you, but I'm tired of that. I'm tired of the enemy dictating how my day is going to go.
Right.
And sometimes it's not even got to do my issue with things that happen. It's just sometimes the enemy calls me to waste time.
Right. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You can spend an hour flipping through Facebook and Instagram,
yeah.
Snapchat. You can sit there and Twitter. Christian Mingle, whatever site, you can sit there and hours flipping. And you know what? You're watching somebody else's life instead of investing into your own.
Amen.
God will give you a vision, and guess what? The one thing that the enemy will try and get you on is the enemy will try and get you to waste time.
Uh-huh.
The enemy will try and get you to be distracted. You ain't had no date in 15 years. As soon as you start your purpose, you got a date. Yeah. Somebody told me, I like you.
Right.
Counterfeit. It's counterfeit.
Amen.
Because all they try to do is put you off your purpose.
Amen.
If they don't fit into your purpose, they're a distraction.
Yeah.
Did y'all make sense? Am I making sense?
Yeah.
And so here it is. You start pursuing the kingdom. Now you got a distraction.
Right.
And he know he can't get you with the flat tire. Because he know you're going to recognize it. But he'll come subtly and get you, instead of working on your business plan, you'll watch a whole day full of Game of Thrones. So y'all, some of y'all ain't with me. But I watched to the midnight hour. I didn't get no sleep watching Game of Thrones trying to catch up. Okay? And what I realize is, those hours that I spent investing into that, I didn't invest it. I don't even read the Bible that long. Oh, y'all don't want to hear me. Y'all don't want to hear me. I would invest time. Your pastor will invest time. Watch, if I add it up on Sunday morning, on Sundays, after church, football, I take 7 hours. Plus, there's a game at 5:30. I'll watch the game at 5:30 and then start replaying. The only reason why I have cable is so I can watch NFL Red Zone. That's the only reason why I have it. So that I can watch sports. Listen, I would spend hours watching sports, but when I read the Bible, I start getting sleepy.
Yeah.
Y'all don't want to. I can sit there all day and watch somebody else make money. But as soon as I really get into what's going to give me life, the devil will make me sleepy. Y'all don't, okay. I'm by myself. So you have to understand, it's a trick of the enemy to try and get you. Why is it that churches will be full but Bible study won't?
Right.
Where you have to study and actually look in the scripture for yourself, that's scarce. Why is it all week long you can wake up early to go to work? But on Sundays, for some reason, you wake up but you're tired. Anybody? You got to hit snooze 75 times? if you're anything like me, you wake up, you put the, I don't know about y'all, but for me, I'll put the doggone alarm an hour before so I can hit snooze like 6 times. Because I know if I put it at the time, I ain't going to get no snoozing in. And I got to take my time to wake up on a Sunday. But on a Tuesday, I'll just automatically get up at 6 o'clock. Just because the light came in my window. Just because the sun shined in my window. Now I'm awake. But on a Sunday, it's hard. Why is it? It's because the system is set up to keep you conformed to this earthly realm. It does not want you Trust me when I tell you, it does not want you to come into the knowledge of the kingdom.
Yes.
Because if you come into the knowledge of the kingdom, you are no longer bound by the system of this world.
Yes.
Did y'all hear me?
Yes.
When you come into the knowledge of the kingdom, when you are enlightened about the kingdom, then it breaks away. Like, the more you get enlightened about the kingdom, the more you walk in benefit.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And you break the chains of this realm. So now, listen, now you get to experience God in a different way than you did when you was just in church.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Does that make sense? Because y'all real quiet, and I don't care. It's good, me. Real quick, let's go to Ephesians. I'm going to go where we led off. We're going to go where we ended up, and then we're going to go into what this new revelation God wants to give us tonight. Let's go to Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 7. Ephesians 2.
And you were dead in your trespasses and sins,
mm-hmm.
in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world,
mm-hmm.
according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience.
Mm-hmm.
Among them were we too, all formerly lived in the lust of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us,
mm-hmm.
even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus.
Yes. So what he's saying to us is that when you're born again, he said, "How can I see the kingdom?" He said, "You must be born again. I can't just go back in my mother's womb." Like he said, "You must be born of the Spirit." You know, y'all read that. And what we have to understand is that when we talk about being born again, salvation was not just something that gets us to heaven. And I know that that's what we've been taught, that salvation is just getting us to heaven. But guess what? Salvation is more than that. Salvation is salvaging us from here.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's it.
So I'm saving you. Now, I'm not saving you for me to be with me.
Uh-huh.
I'm saving you from being with him.
Right.
So I'm saving you from something to something. While I'm here, then what am I being saved from? That's one good old question, huh? So since I'm here, because I'm not living in heaven yet, I know I'm saved from the enemy when I'm in heaven, but what am I saved from here? He didn't just save you to go to church.
Right.
So now that's what you do. That's all you do is you go to church. That's all you do on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. If you ain't at this church, you at somebody else's church. You ain't at this prayer meeting, you at somebody else's prayer meeting. Because all you feel is though your life is supposed to be devoted to. And that's great. If that's how you feel you should live. But he didn't save you just to go to church.
Right.
Amen. Mm. That's right. You hear me? Now, listen. He didn't save you so you can continue living like you used to live either.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But what he did is, in his salvation, one of the kingdom business is he extended grace to you. Y'all remember that?
Yes.
The first thing he extended was grace to you. If you read in the Ephesians 2 chapter verse 8, it says, "For by grace." That's one of our favorite scriptures here. "For by grace are you saved through faith." But before that, he extended it from you, for you. And then when you received it, now you have an abundance of grace.
Yes.
And now you have mercy, goodness and mercy following you.
Right.
So he extended grace before you, and when you said yes to the grace, then as a result, you got goodness and mercy following you.
Yes.
And it says all the days of your life. So every day, even though it don't look good, and even though it look like it's not no mercy on your life, there's goodness and mercy following right behind you.
Yes.
You sin, mercy, Lord. Mercy stands up.
Yes.
Something bad happens, goodness stands up.
Right. Yes. Yeah.
Do you recognize it, though? Do you recognize his goodness in your situation?
Yeah.
Or do you complain in your situation? Y'all quiet, talk. Yes, do you or no? Because we got to work on these things. These are the things that keep us. This is the thing that, because I do not want to read this Bible in 2018 and not experience the benefits of this Bible.
Amen.
Yeah, true.
It makes no sense for us to come and be a part of LRM, of any church, and not experience the benefits of what this Bible possesses.
So you asked us if we recognize the goodness in situations that are not so good, as I put it. And I think that that's a part of renewing our mind. That, you know, if we renew our mind, we are reminded of the fact that there is goodness in all situations.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, well, you know, in situations that are not so good.
Mm-hmm. You was right first time at all.
With all situations. Mm-hmm. So, if we're not renewing our mind, not only daily, but like just every second, because our minds run all the time. It's constant, so it's a constant thing. It's a discipline about renewing our mind. So the more disciplined we are in renewing our mind, the more we can recognize that God is good in all of our situations.
Mm-hmm. That's that one word you said, discipline.
Yeah.
You have to be disciplined to renew your mind. You have to be disciplined to renew your mind. You have to be disciplined to renew your mind. I'm going to say it one more time. You have to be disciplined to renew your mind. Because if you're not disciplined in renewing your mind will wander off.
Yes, that's
true. You'll start out thanking God, and you'll start, and within the hour, you'll be cussing Him. You'll start off saying, Lord, I bless you. The next minute, you're complaining.
Yeah.
I don't know about y'all, but there have been times I had a schizophrenic mind.
Yeah.
Oh, schizophrenia, that old devil. As soon as I woke up, Lord, this is going to be a good day. Something happened. Now I got to figure it out. Now I got to think about it. And then I got to think about what I'm going to say. Because James said that the tongue is an unruly evil.
Uh-huh.
You can't control it. Because for most of us, as soon as we think about it, it come out.
Yeah.
I was in a situation yesterday, having a good day. And somebody sent me a screenshot of something that was kind of about me. And it came up here. Oh, it came right here. To the tip. But I sent something back, and I was like, you know what? I apologize that you had to go through this, or you had to do this, blah, blah, blah. And she was like, you don't have to apologize. And then I said, but yes, I do. I said, because they won't apologize to you, but I will apologize to you. Even though I didn't do it, they did it. I'm going to apologize to you on their behalf. I think she was probably like, that ain't what I call. You know, but I disciplined myself. Listen, I disciplined myself to where I'm not going to allow everything to come out my mouth.
Right.
And guess what that comes in? Renewal.
Yeah.
That comes in renewal because it's going to try you.
Uh-huh.
It's going to try you. And so the first thing you get is grace. Then you get, the second thing you get raised up.
Amen.
Somebody say raised up.
Raised up.
Raised up means I'm at a higher level than I was before. Or I'm coming out of where I was. I get to come out of the dead thing. He stood at the gate and he said, Lazarus, come forth.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
When Jesus showed up, Jesus cannot be around anything dead.
Yes.
All right.
Okay. Oh. That's for somebody in the room. Jesus cannot stand at his. Jesus can't be in your house and something dead in your house and he don't get up. Either he don't get up or get out.
Mm-hmm.
Either way, you win.
Yes. Absolutely. Amen.
Jesus, If you invite Jesus in your bank account, you can't have dead finances in your bank account if he in it.
Right, right.
Okay, okay. Because he has resurrecting power, and anything, if you remember, anything that was near him, that was dead, unless he cursed it, cursed that fig tree, and he was like, bye. But when the girl was dead, he's like, she sleep, get up. When they was going with a funeral, he wasn't coming for them, but he was on his way somewhere, and there was somebody there. He was like, no, sir, that boy sleep, get up out of that. They were taking him. He was dead. So the thing is that when Jesus is invited into your situation, whatever's dead, he said, let the dead bury the dead. Right. That means if it's dead, if it's a dead relationship, that's why you don't have it.
Right, right, right.
If it's a dead friendship, that's why it's not there. If it's dead connection, that's why it has to go. Why? Because there's no way the life and death going to be in the same room.
Right.
There's got to be either one. And many of us, as we grow and we enlighten ourselves and we acknowledge him and we start getting awakened to the kingdom, guess what? Some things that were dead that we were comfortable with, we're not comfortable with them anymore.
Right. Yeah.
Have you started inviting Jesus in some situations and all hell start breaking loose because that thing that you was comfortable with, listen, it done got shook up?
Right.
They didn't change, you did. We done grew apart. Yes, you did.
Yeah. Yep.
Because when he got up, you got up.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You can, when you accept him, you can't stay in the same place. Right. Why do you even want to?
Right.
Y'all some quiet people.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's familiar. Yeah, I know it's familiar. It would have been familiar for Lazarus to stay with them grave clothes, but he said, no, get up. Then his next command was take his clothes, take what was binding him, take it off. Because I don't even want him to associate himself with the cave.
Right.
Oh, that's good stuff. You ain't going to even have the stench of death on you. You ain't going to have the stench of what you were. You came out of depression. You keep saying that. You keep testifying that you came out of depression. Look here. At some point, you ain't going to... Folks ain't gonna even know you. They're gonna be like, how do you?
Right, yeah.
They're not gonna even believe when you tell the story that you were depressed because you're gonna be so far removed from death.
Yes.
To where people are not gonna believe it's you.
Right.
Yes.
And the third thing, I gotta move on. The third thing is, he said, you are now seated.
All right.
Now you're gonna be.
Alright.
And this is where it gets tricky because what he's calling us to is right now. I told you there are three words you should have in your vocabulary. Right now. Immediately. And so he said right now, when you're born again, you are now seated in heavenly places. You're seated next to Jesus the Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
Who is seated on the right hand of the Father.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to say that again. Okay.
Yes.
And I'm going to read it slow. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us.
Us.
Where?
In the heavenly
with him. In the heavenly realms. In Christ Jesus. And he raised us up and seated us next to him.
Amen.
Now, last time I checked, he said that after he left, he was seated next to on the right hand, y'all read that too,
right,
of the Father.
Right.
So if he's seated on the right hand of the Father, and I'm raised up with Jesus, and I'm seated next to him, That means I'm two chairs.
Right. Yeah.
Away from the Father.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm two chairs away. So that means I'm in the same realm as him.
Right.
So that's why I can look over and ask him anything.
Yeah.
And he'll give it to me because I'm seated next to him. Open their mind. You can go boldly before the throne because you see it there.
Yeah.
But if you don't know that, you'll accept that you're here in this realm.
Yeah.
And you'll operate based on this realm instead of operating based on the kingdom realm. And what I want you to get your mind out and stop thinking from this perspective. And start looking from a kingdom perspective. And start seeing, what did he say about me?
Right. Yeah.
Okay, all right then.
Yeah.
Go to 1 Peter. Because I get too excited. Y'all just be looking at me like South Park.
You say go to 2 Peter?
No. 1 Peter, no, 2.
Let me see.
So, what does he say about you? Go to 1 Peter 2, 9 and 10. Somebody read that, please.
But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
Go to verse 10.
Which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
Here you go with that mercy again. Then he said that what I call you is royalty. You are a royal priesthood. You are a royal priesthood. On earth, you don't look like royal priesthood to me. By the 2020 vision of the eye, you don't look like royal priesthood living here. But when he sees you, you are royalty because you're seated next to him.
Amen.
Okay, so royal priesthood, think about this. That's kingdom talk.
Uh-huh, yes.
Yeah.
Okay, that's how people in the kingdom talk to each other. They talk to each other, they call each other duke. And pagans, peasants, princes, princesses, gods. That's how they talk in kingdoms. Lords.
Yeah.
Uh huh. You have positions in kingdoms.
Mm-hmm.
And your status, the higher your status, the more the closer it means, the closer you are into the court. So royalty means you're in the king's court.
Uh-huh. Right.
Or y'all don't want to.
Uh-huh.
Help me, Holy Ghost. Royalty means you are in with your lying self, with your disobedient self, with your not going to church self, with your texting and not paying no attention self. I hope that y'all wasn't. But you with all your negative attributes somehow wound up in the court.
Right.
Do y'all know what y'all life used to be? I know you get up in church and that kind of you're saved all your life. But I've seen some of your outfits. I've seen some of your cuts. I done seen some of your Facebooks, the old pictures. I done seen some of the stuff that you had in your hand. Do you know where you came from?
Right.
And now he calling you royal priesthood?
Right.
You went from that to the court.
Right.
With a matter of a belief.
Right.
And a confession.
Yeah.
You went from this system to a whole system where now you are royalty. You went from peasantry to royalty in a matter of minutes. And what the enemy's job is to keep you as a peasant. Because as long as you can keep you as a peasant, listen, you will never go in and get the gold.
Right.
You'll just sit back and beg for bread and crumbs.
Right.
Oh, y'all. Because like you said, you just said it, because you feel like you don't deserve it.
Yeah.
You don't feel like you deserve for God to bless you because what you did. And so, therefore, you don't even view yourself as, and I'm just trying to elevate your mind.
Yes.
So you can start seeing yourself as God's, because once you start seeing yourself as God sees you, the enemy is in trouble in your life. The enemy is going to start running from you instead of you running from the enemy. You're going to go start looking for trouble. Like, where you at today? It's because trouble is always coming after you, because I know that if I can distract her, she'll never get to where God, she'll never ever ask God for the gold. Even though the gold is hers. Even though that which she really desires in her heart, she can attain it. He can do it. He can make it through this. Yeah. But as long as I keep him distracted and think he just got to beg for crumbs, and that God's will for you is for you to keep begging people and begging the system. If I can keep your mind there, you will never elevate your mind to where you see it. You're seated. Listen, you're seated next to him.
Right, right.
All right.
Who's seated next to him?
Right.
So why won't you utilize him? Right. Even if you don't want to talk to the one over here.
Right, right.
Even if you don't want to talk to the big guy.
Right.
Even if you're scared to talk to God, you got an advocate and you have an intercessor that you can talk to.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
You can go, Jesus, tell the Lord that I'm in need of blah, blah, blah.
Exactly.
Thank you. And guess what? When you start operating from the spirit,
right,
instead of your flesh, you'll see different results.
You know, Pastor, you tell us all the time to, you know, read the Word, read our Bible. Because in the Amplified version, verse 9 says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a dedicated nation, God's own purchase, special people, that you may set forth the wonderful deeds and display the virtues and perfection of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people at all, but now you are God's people. Once you were unpitied, but now you are pitied and have received mercy. And so when you just think about that, like, this is what Christ Jesus is telling us, that we're chosen, that at one point in time we were not even a people together, but now we are God's people, that we are truly set apart. I mean, that's good news.
And I want all people, all my people, I want them to live like I'm about to live.
Come on now.
From a kingdom mindset.
All right.
Yeah.
I got to shift this. Oh, y'all don't
care.
I got to shift this, and I'm learning how to, but it takes a renewal. And it can't just be two times a week. It can't just be one. I have to renew this every day. That I'm a kingdom citizen. Y'all used to sing it. Citizens of God. My ancient used to sing that. Kingdom. I don't remember the rest of it, but I know that was that.
You got benefit.
You got benefit.
Yeah.
We didn't even know at the time what we were singing, but we were prophetically declaring you got benefits and didn't even know it that we had them.
Right.
And what I'm trying to do is say, you got benefits, you got mail, open it.
Yeah.
If I brought a check, listen, if I gave everybody an envelope and I don't tell you what's in it, half of you would open it and half of you wouldn't. Mm-hmm. But if I'm telling you, here's a check, 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 check, check. Everybody got checks. If I tell everybody that, everybody gonna open it. Right? Everybody gonna be excited to see what's in the check. I'm telling you right now, that this is a check, this is a check, this is a check, 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 check. And whatever you need is found right here in the fact that you have been seated next to the, and guess what? What I learned, this is what I learned. Denise, this was good to me. This was good to me. Y'all didn't get it last week. I hope y'all get this week, and then we're going to move on. What I did learn is that now he said that let us make man, right?
Yeah.
In the image, in our image, in our likeness.
Right?
Yeah. In Matthew, it said Jesus had gotten baptized, right?
Right.
And he came up and God said, this is my son, in whom I was well pleased. There was one.
Yeah.
Then Jesus was there, and then the Holy Spirit descended as a dove.
Right.
So you saw three right there.
Right. Yeah.
If he said, you are seated next to Jesus, and Jesus is sitting next to the Father, where then is the Spirit?
Inside of us.
Yeah.
Where?
It's us.
Where?
It's us. We are.
Please don't say it with a question mark.
We are the Spirit.
You received. He said, I left this. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I left me.
Right.
So you can receive me inside of you.
Right.
So you can sit in. So you can occupy the seat.
Yeah.
Okay. Y'all, okay. I feel down on that one.
Yeah.
So y'all don't want it today. So Jesus is here, but he said you are seated.
Yeah.
Next to Jesus, right?
Uh-huh.
But he said I'm going to lead you a comforter.
Yeah.
Which is a part of the three.
Yeah.
Which is, he said, greater is he that's in you than he that is occupying this world. And what he said to you is, I left me with you down here because up there, you're the one seated next to me. Okay, I'll say that again. You're seated in heavenly places next to Jesus. But he left you, he left himself, so that you can be here and still have the same effect.
Right.
As if you're seated up there.
Right.
Because he's here inside you.
Right.
And guess what? If you're talking to him up there in the spirit, that means your answer is coming here. Because I got dual citizenship. So guess what? My benefits that's here, I just need to bring them over and transfer them from that account to this one.
Yeah.
My father is rich. Let me transfer that from his bank account to mine.
Yeah.
Why? Because I'm seated next to him.
Right.
And so when you find out who you are, then the enemy can't just mess with you with little stuff.
Right.
We start tripping over little stuff, and we forget that all things work together.
Exactly.
The reason why it works together is because where I'm sitting.
Exactly.
You can't mess with me, and I'm sitting next to him. Okay. I done got too happy. I'm gonna turn down. I'm gonna tone down, and we're gonna leave in a minute because y'all tired. I'm tired. We don't really want.
But that's good news.
That's good news.
You don't really know
how to I'm work. Really juiced about
you
it.
You really know how to work that thing right there.
If you learn it, if you learn the principle, that's why, think about this. Baisha, I'm so excited, but y'all are excited. But listen, think about this. If I'm seated next to Jesus, and Jesus is next to the God, right? That's why when he said, let there be, then there was. That's why he said death and life and the power of your tongue. Because if he's inside you, you've seen it in heaven and heaven. Whatever you say has to come.
Right.
So if you speak it as if he spoke it.
Yeah. Oh my goodness. Yeah.
He's inside of you, right?
Right.
And it's out of the abundance of your heart when you speak. And if you're now a spirit man living in this natural world, because technically now you're a spirit.
Right.
You're a spirit.
Right, right.
And if you walk in the spirit, you get to say what you see, want to see. So guess what? When I'm here, that's why I get to say, this day I will have what I want. Not just what I need.
Right.
Okay, y'all.
Right.
See, what we thought is that because we say stupid stuff in church. He may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. That's stupid. That's ignorant. Why? Let me tell you why. Because he's omnipresent.
Right.
Which means he's already here.
Yeah.
And if you here, that means he's here. Because he's inside of you. Where is he coming from?
Yeah.
Okay, y'all don't hear me. No, he may not come when you want. Where is he coming from? Where is he coming from to get to you late?
Right.
He may not come when you want him. That means he's late. By my standards, he's late.
Right.
So where did he have to travel from to get to me in my circumstances and then arrive late?
Because we are taught religion.
Yeah.
I'm learning how to access myself. I know you saying this and that, but I'm like, well, wait a minute. God said I can have it.
Uh-huh.
So if he said I can have it, it's mine.
Uh-huh.
So now I'm changing the mindset, because it's almost like when you grow up in church, little all the way up, it is a form of bondage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you're bound to this thing, and you know that it's got to be this hard. It has to be this way when you just need to go a different route.
Yeah.
So it's just... it's something. So now I'm accessing myself.
There's a couple of y'all accessing your stuff. And I'm like, and it's blowing my mind how God is doing it. Like, we could have been doing this a long time ago.
That's generational.
Yes. It's getting on my nerves. It makes me mad. I'm about to say the word. It makes me mad that I could have been accessing the kingdom a long time ago. I just never knew I had access. I just thought we supposed to come to church, be good Christians, shout, don't drink, don't cuss, don't have sex, don't do that, don't cheat, don't lie, or don't do the don'ts. That's all I thought we were supposed to do, and we supposed to worship. I never looked at it as I'm supposed to come learn how to live.
Right.
While I'm here, I'm supposed to have this kingdom on earth.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You asked about the key. The key, he said, I'm giving you the keys to the kingdom.
Right.
That whatever you bind in heaven
will be bound
on earth. How do you bind it? With your mind.
Yeah.
And then he said, whatever you loose in heaven will be loose in earth. Why? Because you're seated next to him.
Right.
So whatever you loose on in heaven, you get to loose it here on earth. I bind the spirit of poverty in my house.
Yeah.
If you bind it there, you bound it here.
Right.
I break the generational curse over my family.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you speak it in the spirit,
uh-huh,
it's as if you broke it here.
Yeah.
I lose prosperity, yeah, not just for me, but for me and my house.
Right.
I lose favor over my house. Guess what? When you speak it, guess who you're speaking it to? Where are you? Where are you?
In the realm.
And you're in the realm.
Yeah.
You're in the realm. Who are you next to?
Jesus.
Who is next to who?
God.
So when you speak it, who are you speaking it to?
God.
You're speaking it in the realm where he can get it done.
Yeah.
And he said, whatever you lose up here is going to be loose where you at.
Yeah, right.
It's like speaking to yourself.
Yes. Yes.
It's so good. Jesus will tell you. He'll even give you a clue or tell you what you need to be saying. But, you know, we have a problem listening. So, yes. But he'll even, if you don't know what to say or you don't know, he'll whisper it to you. He'll give you, okay, ask for this. Okay, go get this. Or, and then it's up to you to speak it through.
You know what? Stephanie tried to be prophet, somebody prophet on Sunday. Mm-hmm. She came to me to my stand at the door. She said, no, you know how prophets shine me deep. She said, whatever it is that you want from God, go get it. I said, is this like a joke? Or is this like are you just playing, or is this something like you feel spiritually led? He was like, she's like, no, I'm spirit. I'm speaking to you in the spirit. So now, funny thing, but I changed the way I listened.
Yeah.
I said, say it again. She said, whatever you need from God, go get it. Mm-hmm. And so I started thinking, Lord, what I need from you? Let me go ahead and start. Because if that was the word, if that was the word for me right at that moment, then I need to start hearing from him to access what it is. Because you know what? For a long time, I've never asked God for anything. Mm-hmm. I never would ask God. To this day, I probably have never asked God for anything except dealing with this church. I've never really asked God for anything for myself. And so I realized I had to research why. And they had to take me, the devil, you know, the Lord will take you all the way back to childhood. He'll take you and do it. He was like, because you don't trust me as your father, because you didn't trust your own. Hmm. What? Hmm. Huh? He's like, you don't trust me as a provider because your dad never did it. Huh. So you felt like you never asked anybody for anything because you don't want them to let you down.
Yeah.
So you won't even ask me because you don't think I'll give it to you, and you think I'm gonna let you down. I had to repent to God the Father, because really I did. I don't want to ask you for something and then you not do it, and I get disappointed in you.
Yeah.
And he said, prove me. So I'm gonna try something. This week I'm gonna try something. y'all don't hear me? Y'all don't hear me. I'm about to walk out of faith, and I'm going to try something. Did y'all catch me? I'm about to try something. I'm going to ask, I'm going to be like, Lord, blah. And no matter what it looks like, I'm going to call it till it come. Then I'm going to tell you about it. I ain't going to tell you before. I'm going to tell you after. I'm going to be like, guess what happened? Now that you're not about to, y'all going to do cartwheels after that. But the thing is that most of us, we feel like we don't deserve to ask anything from the Lord. So we don't ask him until we get in trouble. Then we ask him to get us out of the trouble. That's most of our prayers, is get us out of this.
Yeah.
Get us out of it. Mine is, where you are, man, where you at in this? Mm-hmm. Don't get me out of this, because you're in here somewhere. Let me find you.
Yeah.
Because I know if you're in here, you're making me sharper, you're making me better. Because if I'm in fire, that means I'm coming out like gold. Mm-hmm. That means I'm going to come shining like a diamond.
Yeah.
If I'm in fire, if I'm in famine, that means you're about to feed me. There's about to be some rain coming.
Yeah.
Whatever situation I'm in, I'm learning that, oh, wherever you are, that's where that river is. And wherever that river is, that's where the supply is. So I ain't gonna even get to this. There are two groups of people. There are two groups of people, and I'm not gonna be able to get to all of this because y'all ain't got me talking about the seed, and I done got a little happy about the seed. I done woke up. That seed done woke me up. That seed woke me up. There are two groups of people. One group is the group who enjoys the benefits that we are entitled to. It seems like the Lord increases them year by year, day by day. you look at them and they really do mean they blessed and highly favored the Lord when you ask them how they're doing. Mm-hmm. They always got a smile on their face. They always feel like they when you know they're like triple. Every time something happens, hallelujah, they got their hands go up. And they mean it. It's not a forced thing. But then the second group of Christians are the people who love God just as much as the first group.
Uh-huh.
But they don't enjoy none of the benefits. Something always wrong with them. I don't know about you, but I want to be in group A.
Mm-hmm.
I think I've been in group B long enough. Mm-hmm. Is anybody with me?
Yeah.
Let's look at this. I'm gonna take you through. Let's go to Matthew 13, verse 19. We're not gonna be able to go through all of this because there are four. Matthew 13. Verse 19. And what I'm going to look, I want you to look at is we're going to look at four different conditions, and we'll finish this next week. So I'm just going to introduce this. Jesus always talked in parables, right?
Yes.
And so what he did was he was giving four different conditions of soil.
Mm-hmm.
Four different conditions of soil. Okay. Now, of the four different conditions of soil, one benefited, three didn't. One benefited, three didn't. So one provided a harvest, three didn't. So we want to figure out which one we operating in. So if we're not benefiting, we can get in the one that is. Does that make sense?
Uh-huh.
So let's go to Matthew 13, verse 19.
The hard path where some of the seeds fell represents the heart of a person who hears the good news about the kingdom and doesn't understand it. Then Satan comes and snatches away the seeds from his heart.
So, it's called the what path?
The hard path.
The hard path or the foot path. The mm-hmm. hard path, in some translation, is the foot path. Do y'all see that in y'all Bibles?
Yeah.
Does anybody have anything else? Some different? So it's either the hard path or the foot path. Matthew 13, 19. Okay. It says, the first one that ain't going to benefit is the one that hears the good news about the kingdom. And the kingdom is good news.
Uh-huh.
The gospel is good news.
Uh-huh.
I hope you're finding out that the gospel is not an oppressive gospel, but gospel is a good news. This is, and that's why he kept preaching the kingdom of God. If you know, Jesus kept calling the kingdom of God. He said, the one that ain't going to benefit is the one who don't understand it.
Right.
Yeah.
Where we're teaching it, and it's going in one ear and out the other. He said, what Satan does what? Satan comes along, and he's going to pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
So your seed that you want to plant, you can't even plant it into the ground because guess what? Satan done picked it up because you never even gotten aware of. You didn't even become enlightened. You can't get excited about something you don't understand.
Yeah.
Right.
That's why I got to do things in series and take my time because I can't rush through the kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I can't rush through because you ain't going to learn everything about it tonight. You still gonna have to eat some, and you're gonna spew some back out, and then you're gonna have to go back and you're gonna digest some more. Because what you need to end up with, you need to have a full understanding of who you are in the kingdom. Because I can talk about who you are in the kingdom all day long. If you don't get it, you're gonna still start out tomorrow morning. You're gonna wake up, there's gonna be something that happened, and now you're gonna go back to cussing. Because you never understood who you are. Do y'all know where y'all are? Do y'all at least understand? Let's make sure. Do you understand that you're seated next to?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So at the end of the day, when we preach that, when you leave here, don't lose it.
Mm-hmm.
Did y'all get that? When you leave here, don't then become common again.
Right. Right. Yeah. Right. Right. Right.
Don't become a peasant like you, if you came in the door peasant, and you realize now that you are part of, you seated next to God the Father and God the Son, that seat next to them is you, then why would you go back and put on peasant clothes? When he called you royalty.
Yes.
Does that make sense? And so what happens when you don't understand, how many of you ever read the Bible and never understood it?
Yeah.
What he does then, he takes the seed, mm-hmm. and implants the seed of discouragement in you.
Right.
Now you don't want to read.
Yeah.
Because I don't want to take the time to read something I can't understand. So I'll wait. Listen, I'll wait till somebody tells me what it said.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I'll never read it for myself. I'll never study it for myself. Mm-hmm. But I'll wait till the pastor tell me what it said. And depending upon what the pastor said,
uh-huh.
now I have a whole view of the Bible that really wasn't true.
Because
I put my dependence on somebody because I didn't understand it. Now the enemy, guess what he did? He took my seed of the kingdom and planted religion in it. And religion has no benefit. There's 5,000 different religions. Religion has no benefit. Kingdom does.
Yeah.
Okay? Y'all got that?
Yeah.
Woo! I gotta hurry up. Because I'm about to run out here. I'm about to run. Go to go to Matthew. Stay there. Uh-huh. Matthew 13, do 20 and 21.
The shallow, rocky soil represents the heart of a man who hears the message and receives it with real joy. But he doesn't have much depth in his life. And the seeds don't root very deeply. And after a while, when trouble comes, or persecution begins, because of his beliefs, his enthusiasm fades and he drops out.
Listen, the second thing to solve, I hope this is good to y'all like it's good to me.
It's good.
It's rocky soul. And what it's saying is, you get happy in the moment.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
You get happy because you heard it. You get happy because God gonna bless me. Touch your neighbor. God gonna bless me real good. Some of y'all, when I said it, 3 days, God's gonna change something. Some people took it as a happy moment.
Yeah.
But some people took this thing as a declaration.
Oh yeah.
That God is about to change some things. Mm-hmm. And so guess what? Now, listen, the people who just got happy for the moment, when something happens to them, when they go out and something happens, when they go and you've heard the word and something happens that's contrary to the word that you heard, now you fall to pieces.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Because the word didn't take root and you ain't got no deep roots. Your roots is not in the kingdom. Your roots is in religion. Y'all didn't get me.
Yeah.
Your root is in church, not in God.
Yeah, right.
So anything can cause you not to come.
Yeah. Right.
Ain't old go, y'all. That's all right. Anything can cause you not to be on point today or really even hear the word today, because all you're listening for is what's good to you.
Yeah.
Right. What's going to benefit you? Am I going to get a new car today? Am I going to get, is he going to tell me that if I turn around 3 times, click my heel, and tomorrow I'm going to have the rain going to fall, and the rain is going to be filled with money, and it's going to be around my feet. That's what I want to hear. And I'm going to shout over that, but then tomorrow, when the bill is due, I don't believe God that the rain is coming. Because guess what? I haven't set myself in the word, so I ain't got no roots.
Right.
Yes, ma'am.
Like they say, rocks shift. So when rocks move, you become unwavered, and it's like you're not grounded anymore. So you now it's just like now I got to start all over again. I'm not very deep enough. Like she says, you're not, your roots not deep. So that right now, every time the rocks open up, it's just like, oh, I can just walk out of it. I'm loose. I'm start all over. Now you're mad because you can get no deep in the good soil.
Well, look, I'm talking.
Okay.
Rocks. I got a little revelation. And that's exactly what happens.
Yeah.
You shift because it never, listen, it went on rocky soil. The seed can't go on the rocky soil.
Right.
Because it'll never penetrate on rocks.
Right.
So therefore, the word never penetrated you. So therefore, the kingdom of God is just something, it's a concept, but it's not a reality.
Right.
Right.
It's a concept, and it sounds good. But because you haven't prepared your heart in worship, you haven't prepared your heart in worship, you cannot receive it on good soil. Yes?
Yes.
We got two more, and we're going to go two more. Go on to 13:22.
The ground covered with thistles represents a man who hears the message, but the cares of this life and his longing for money choke out God's word, and he does less and less for God. Oh, Lord. Less than thistles.
In my Bible, it calls them thorns. And this is the person who you hear the word of God, just like the last person. You hear the word of God, but then the cares of life come.
Yeah.
And you're so worried about it to where you start backing away from church.
Mm-hmm.
And you start backing away from the Lord. I got people in my head who this is. I know I've been number one and number two. And sometimes number three. Well, Lord, I'm done with. Have you ever said, Lord, I'm done with church.
Mm-hmm.
I'm done with your people.
Yeah,
I done said that since I've been a pastor. I had just started. I was like, Lord, these stiff-necked people.
So you know what it means now?
Oh, I know what it means. I knew what it meant then. Uh-huh. I just didn't want to say it with the family in there. Y'all family, but they ain't family yet, so they can't see that side. But my point is that, think about this, is that you hear the same word, you hear the same gospel, and some will fall off. You got people who will preach, and they used to preach. Now they don't preach no. They was hearing the same word. They used to sing.
Mm-hmm.
Now they bitter. And you don't let the cares of life take you out.
Yeah.
But you heard the same word. He said, he called it thorny or thistles.
Yeah.
And that's because it's filled with thorns. Because the word of God is a seed that's planted. And it can't be planted on a place full of thorns.
All right.
Yeah.
You don't want to be hurt. You gotta just walk away even if it's true.
Yeah. But the funny thing about it, we still shout over the word,
right.
But because life then becomes life, we don't activate the word, and we blame God for it.
Yeah.
And now it's his fault. Now you don't pray no other day except once a week when you come to church. But it's God's fault why you didn't get that promotion. It's God's fault why you lacking in this area or that. Let me give you one more. We go. Now this is the one that we need to be.
The good ground represents the heart of a man who listens to the message and understands it and goes out and brings 30, 60, or even 100 others into the kingdom.
Okay. He said, I want you to read that again. Because you would think that they would go out and then get a car. Or go out and get a new job. But he said that good store people go get more people.
The good ground represents the heart of a man who listens to the message and understands it and goes out and brings 30, 60, or even 100 others into the kingdom.
So what good soul people do? Good soul people, they go out and they get more people in the kingdom by living the kingdom out.
Amen.
They hear it. They hear it. They hear that I'm seated next to God the Father and Jesus. And what I do is now I understand my position, so I stop complaining on my job, right? I stop complaining against people. I stop being the one that they can bring gossip to. Mm-hmm. I start implementing things because God is now giving me wisdom. God gives me witty, little, simple things to do, even if it's highs and hugs. And yeah. You know what? You look beautiful today. I when I walk in the door, I change atmosphere because I know who I am now. And now people are drawn to the kingdom.
Yes.
And now God trusts me with more stuff because He's doing. My whole purpose is to share with other folk. And what I do is I get and I give. I get and I give. And I get more and then I give. And I get more and then I give. And then I get more and then I give. And the more that I give, the more that I get.
Oh, yeah.
So if I get joy, I give it. So guess what? He trusts me with a whole barrel of joy because he knows I'm going to give it out to everybody around me. If I get money, I give money. Okay, y'all don't want to hear me. If I get good words and get good kindness, I give it to other people. Yes, ma'am.
Is that like when they say, don't give the person the fish, teach them how to fish, like, have food for all
the rest of their day? It's something like that. Because what we want to do is make sure, the first time I may give you the fish the first time, but that should be an instruction.
Right.
Because if I give you one fish and you don't manage that wisely, you will be broke and you will not have anything to eat real soon.
Right.
Y'all get that?
Yeah.
So everything that I'm getting, everything that God downloads to me, I'm pouring it out to you so you can get it. And guess what? Make an impact. Let me tell you, I was listening to T.D. Jakes, I think I was telling him, impacts are measured. Impact is measured. I want y'all to write that down.
Mm-hmm.
Impact is measurable or measured. If the God's word is making an impact in your life, you can see it. I can tell the way you talk whether the word is making an impact because it can be measured. Because out of the abundance of your heart, will you speak? If those who God is making a real impact in, they mouth change first.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Their whole conversation begins to change. You don't hear them always, even when they start speaking negative, they start correcting themselves. I am sick. Even if you say I am sick, you are, but if be followed with a body stripes out here. But hold on. Yeah, have y'all ever done that? Y'all go, I'm sick, but by his stripes I'm healed. Eventually, you're going to stop putting the first I am sick.
Right,
because
right.
Think about this. I am means I am. That's who you are.
Right.
So you're calling yourself sickness. Not you're calling sickness from over there to come here. You're calling yourself sick. You're naming yourself sickness.
Right.
Oh, y'all don't want to hear me. Yeah. Because when I introduce myself as I am Bo.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
So when you ask me how I'm doing, they say I am sick. I just reintroduce myself.
Right.
And that's why you're sick, because you called yourself. That's who you introduced yourself as. I am Brooke. That's your name. And names in the Bible mean something.
That's right.
Because guess what? Every name in the Bible described who you were.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
y'all don't want to hear that. Every name in the Bible, they looked at him and said, you are my light, so I'm going to call you blah. So then they introduced themselves as I am blah. So when you say, why don't you say I am rich? Even when your circumstances say you poor, you're introducing yourself as I am rich. See, when you're in the kingdom, stuff makes sense. This whole I am thing now makes sense because of where you've seen it. So even God was saying that I am that I am. Because whatever I need to be at this specific time, I'll introduce myself as such. I am whatever I am. What? That? What is that? I'm provider that day. So when you call me, I introduce myself as provider. So I show up as I am provider. You ain't never seen God say I am sick.
Okay.
Then why do you? And you seated next to him too, I know he be shaking his head like I know he be shaking his head like I'm so sick of Stephanie saying she You see what I'm saying? You're sitting next to God and you speak it ill. It grieves him. It grieves him that you don't even know who you are enough. To where you're seated next to him and you say the opposite of what he just said about you.
Right.
Kingdom benefits. We about to do that.
I was saying, I was watching, I think I yell on Van Zandt on the TV show called Sister Circle or something. And she was saying before she couldn't put anything negative in her mouth, she said what she is first. What we are. We are powerful. We are smart. We are capable of doing anything. And then she'll address the other issue. But she said she empowered yourself first before you tell yourself what you are not. Don't ever put what you are not out there first. Like I said, broke, not able, not capable, not worthy, all those. She said, never put that out there first. Speak what you are, what you should believe you are, and you will be.
Yeah, because this, when we talk about systems, I think we make movement to them. What are the keys and what are the systems? I know she was like, we ain't gonna talk about the key. The keys are gonna come when we talk about the system. Because the way the system is set up is that in the kingdom system, it's let there be and then there was. God said and then he saw. If you read Genesis, they said God says and then he saw. All throughout the Genesis, God said then he saw. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So whatever you say, that then you see.
Right.
Whatever you say, that's what you will see. And I told everybody last week, look at the product of your life. A lot of it is because of what you say. Try this. I know somebody's done it. I know somebody said, I hate my job. I know somebody said, I hate my job. They weren't even at the hate point then. They might have just didn't like it, or didn't feel like going, or didn't like somebody specific. But guess what? The more you said, I hate this job, the more things start happening to where now you really hate it. You dread getting up, going to work. Many marriages could be saved. Many relationships could be saved if you called it different. Many of our financial situations could be changed had we called it different. I've said I'm broke a lot. And guess what? I made money and was broke. How you do that? How you do that? I made money but was broke. Didn't even know where the money went.
Right, right.
But I had to be broke because that's who I declared I was.
Amen.
So I had to be broke because that's who I said I was. The same money I'm making right now, I'm not broke because I don't call it. I'm making the same exact, I'm not in the shop another day extra. And I don't have this random influx of clients. But guess what? My bills are being paid. Whereas now I'm looking and I'm seeing money in the bank, and I'm like, oh, thank you, Jesus. Like, one of the desires of my heart was to help my mom and start taking care of my mom. So I start planting a seed. I'm like, Lord, and I just send her some checks. She don't know this. I send her some checks. Once a month, cash, just check. I send all the way to when we get there in July. Cash, just check, right? And guess what? I believe that I'm going to have more than enough, that when it's time, I'm not going to even be tripping that it came out.
Yeah,
right. Then I'm going to increase it, which then means I'm going to need to get more so I can give her more.
Right.
Then I'm going to increase that because I'm going to start shaping my world by my word.
I was just thinking.
Yeah. No more broke for me. Turn the things off. They done heard enough. Five people. Amen.
Amen. God bless you.
I felt good. I told you